Welcome to the tutorial on finding statistics and journal articles for epidemiology using library resources. To begin your research, open any browser. Yours, like mine, might go automatically to Google, but you actually want to start at the library's homepage, which is medlib.bu.edu. The library has many resources to help you in your research. You can see we have a section for finding books, finding articles, services, and research help. But in general, if you're looking into a specific topic like epidemiology, you might want to try a subject guide. You can look under Subjects A to Z in the upper right-hand side, then click on Subject Guides. Epidemiology is E, so click on D through H. And then go ahead and click on Epidemiology and Biostatistics. Now, a subject guide basically is a guide to the resources available for a particular topic, and they're organized into print resources, books on reserve, ebooks, databases we suggest, e-journals, and recommended websites. And you know that anything on this list is trustworthy because librarians have assembled it for you. So you're starting to look into epidemiology and you decide you want to start with an ebook. Ebooks are easiest to access from your home. So you go ahead and look at the ebooks, and let's go ahead and click here for more ebooks on this subject to see the whole list. And you're browsing through and you see this Health in the United States in 2011. And with you're kind of interested in communicable diseases and your particular field of study is the United States, so you say, hey, that looks good to me, and go ahead and click on it. Now, this particular book is open source, so it doesn't ask you to log in. But if it's a book that we subscribe to through the library for you, you might need to log in with your Kerberos username and password. And most ebooks have a table of contents that's hyperlinked. You can see that each of these is a link, and you can click through to that section. So you're browsing through, and you see prevention of influenza. And that interests you, so you go ahead and click on that. And that brings you to the exact right section of the book. And you can see, it says between 2000 and 2010, influenza vaccination has increased among adults under 65. And you can see these cool little line graphs and things like that. And this is basically a pretty good introduction to epidemiology of various types of diseases in the United States. You can browse it as you like. So then go ahead and click back once, twice, three times to get back to the epidemiology subject guide. Okay, so now you've looked at ebooks and you decided you want to see what websites there are out there for epidemiology. So you go ahead and browse on down to the recommended websites, and you get curious about this thing called Health Map. So go ahead and click on that. And you can see right away that this is a visual tool to help you see visually what types of communicable epidemics might be going on around the world. If you hover over these pins, you can see that each pin tells you the name of the disease that it represents. And you can see we're seeing a lot of the flu in the United States. If we come over to Africa, we see Lassa fever. And if you look down here, you can see that this is an activity index. So these different colors do mean something. Yellow is the lowest prevalence, and red is the highest. You can search by specific disease. Let's go ahead and stick with the flu and put in influenza. And you can see it auto-completes. And go ahead and just select general influenza. And now you can see it just shows us the flu that's going on currently in the world. If you're interested, you can go into advanced search, and you can also narrow by region, and you can also see the list of all the different types of diseases that are possible. So you can narrow by region. Like in this case, we could just say, oh, I just want to look at the United States because there's a lot of flu. Let's take a look at that. And you can also narrow by time period. It auto selects the past week, but you can adjust that as you like, and then go ahead and hit search. And this is the last week of the flu in the United States. So that's a pretty cool visual tool for you to help really see an epidemic. So you check out Health Map and you say, okay, that's pretty cool. But I'm going to go ahead on back to the subject guide again and move on to the next type of resource from there. So the next type of resource you might want to use in your research is a database. If you scroll back up, you can see the recommended databases for epidemiology. The best that I want to show you right now is PubMed. So go ahead and select that, then select it again. It'll prompt you to log in with your BU username and password. PubMed is a free database, but logging in this way lets them know that you're affiliated with BU. And if you look at the citation for an article that we own the full text of, it will let you know that. So it just saves you a step later on. Now, PubMed is a biomedical database run by the U.S. National Library of Medicine and the National Institutes of Health. And basically, any database gathers together different citations of articles and lets you search them. And then you can use those citations that you found to get access to the full text of the articles that you want to read. We've been looking at communicable diseases so far. Let's switch it up and look at a non-communicable disease. So just using the search bar at the top, go ahead and do a natural language search, basically a Google-style search. And let's put in epidemiology of type 2 diabetes. You can see that we get over 20,000 results, which is a lot of results for any one person to go through. Databases have what are called filters or limits that can help you narrow down your search a little bit further. You can see them over on the left-hand side here. Now, one that's really good for epidemiology is systematic review. That's a type of article that looks at all the previous literature published about a particular topic and sums it up for the reader. It's a really good place to start in your research. Now, I'm not seeing it here underneath article types. That's because PubMed doesn't automatically show all the filter options. You need to turn it on to show up. So go ahead and hit more and scroll down alphabetically to systematic review, click the checkbox and hit show. We haven't turned it on yet, we just made it show up, and you want to click on it to turn it on. So now we have systematic reviews of the epidemiology of type 2 diabetes. Another couple of filters that are good for epidemiology are sex and age. And again, these aren't showing up. We can see the additional filters here under show additional filters. And just go ahead and click the checkboxes next to sex and ages and hit show. And you're thinking, well, this is still a little bit too much. Maybe I should narrow my focus. I'm just going to look at adult women. So adults and female. And now you're down to 221 results. This is still a bit much. And you're also looking at it, and this isn't exactly what you were thinking of when you're thinking of the epidemiology of type 2 diabetes. For instance, this first article is about the problems people with diabetes have with their feet. That's not quite the epidemiology slant that you were looking for. Sometimes this natural language or Google-style search works really well right away, and other times it doesn't. It really just depends on what you're researching. If it doesn't work, though, you still have more options. You can use what are called MeSH terms, and that just stands for medical subject heading. Basically, what it is there are a list of terms that a bunch of people sit down and they read the articles and they say, okay, these terms drawn from this list are what this article is about, and they tag them as being about it. It's a lot like when you tag a photo of a friend on Facebook as being that person in that photo. And then later, somebody can look at that person's photo on person's record on Facebook and say, oh, look at all these photos of this person. It's very similar to that. But how do you know what MeSH terms to use? You don't know them off the top of your head like you know your friends' names. What you can do is you can search the MeSH database. It's a lot like a thesaurus. And the way you do that is up here on the left-hand side, there's a drop-down menu. Go ahead and select MeSH. And we want to figure out what MeSH terms are good for our topic that we're researching. So just go ahead and start with the disease and put in diabetes. I usually start with the disease. And it's kind of cool. It's like searching a dictionary and it pulls up all the possible terms that we might want. And if, as you look, you can see the term followed by what's called a scope note, which is basically a definition of the term that helps you pick which one is the most precisely like what you want. You can see some of the words in the scope note are in all capitals. That's just letting you know that those words in all capitals are other MeSH terms. So you look and you see diabetes mellitus type 2 is type 2 diabetes. That's what you want. So go ahead and click on it to open up the full entry for this term. You can see again we have the term and the scope note. We have subheadings. We'll come back to that in a second. We have entry terms. These are just words that you would type in that would bring you to this term. They've decided these terms are all the same as diabetes mellitus type 2. And if you keep scrolling down, you can see where diabetes mellitus type 2 falls in the tree. And basically, MeSH categorizes these terms into a tree that starts broad and ends up narrow. So broadly, you say you have the disease category. And then as you narrow along, you go nutritional, metabolic, glucose, diabetes, mellitus type 2, diabetes, mellitus, lipoatrophic. It's good to pay attention to this tree because if you're getting too many or too few results, you can either broaden or narrow your terms that you're using. But in this case, let's stick with diabetes mellitus type 2, and let's scroll back up to the subheadings. Now, basically, a subheading is if you turn on this term used in association with another term, then you're only looking at that one thing that has to do with, say, diabetes mellitus type 2. So if you turned on history using it with type 2 diabetes, you'd only be getting the history of type 2 diabetes. And there are a couple of subheadings that are really good for epidemiology. One is, surprisingly enough, epidemiology. I'm just going to go ahead and turn that on. And the other is statistics and numerical data, which isn't showing up here, but it's good for you to know that it's a term that you might want to pay attention to. So I've turned on epidemiology, I've got diabetes mellitus type 2, and the next thing I want to do is over on the right-hand side here, there's a PubMed search builder, because we're building together our search using these mesh terms that we want to use in PubMed. And we just want to hit add to search builder. And the reason this is good is because otherwise you would have to type all this punctuation and spelling in yourself, and that's just time-consuming, and it's easier to just hit add to search builder. Now another thing that is useful in epidemiology is regions. Those can be either geographical or fiscal. So you might be interested in, say, just developing or developed countries. That is an option in MeSH. Or you might be interested in actual physical geographical region. In this case, you've decided, okay, the whole world's epidemic of type 2 diabetes is a bit much. I'm just going to look at the United States. And that is an option. And similarly, you could also just narrow it to just North America. Or if you were in Africa, you can narrow to just Western Africa. It doesn't have to be a country. You can also get even narrower with the United States and just look at regions of the United States or just a particular state. But in this case, you want to look at the United States. And if you know that a term is what you want, you don't have to go all the way out to the whole entry to use it. You can just hit the checkbox. And then over here, hit Add to Search Builder. You can see it added automatically with an and. If you wanted to add it with an or not, you would want to select that before you hit Add to Search Builder. So now we have our search and we want to go ahead and search it in PubMed. So go ahead and hit Search PubMed. I know at first it looks like we didn't get many results. That's because the filters we turned on are called sticky filters. They stay on until they're turned off. So let's go ahead and turn them off by hitting Clear All. And now we have just over 2,000 results, which is a lot fewer than the over 20,000 results that we had the first time we tried. And you're scrolling through, and it looks like quite a few of these articles are actually about cardiovascular disease, and that's not what you want. You can further narrow this down by telling PubMed that you don't want cardiovascular disease. And the way you do that is using the drop-down menu, you want to select MeSH again. I'm just going to go ahead and put in cardiovascular disease. And you can tell right away, cardiovascular diseases, that's the term I want. Hit the checkbox, add it to Search Builder, and search PubMed. Now you've noticed that I'm not building my search all over again. That's because I know I can use Advanced Search to help me do that. If you click on Advanced Search, you can see that PubMed has kept track of everything I've done for the last 8 hours. And if you look at it, you can use these records to help you either look back at old search results by clicking the number and hitting Show Search Results, or you can combine different searches together. In this case, we want to combine diabetes mellitus type 2 epidemiology in the United States with not cardiovascular disease. So first hit Add next to the first terms. And then add again next to cardiovascular disease. And you see again, it automatically is combining with an and. We don't want an and, we want a not. So change that to a not, and then hit search. And you can see that now we're down to just over 1,500 results. Now you can also use filters again with your MeSH terms. So just go ahead and return on systematic reviews. And you can see that now you have 46 articles that are a good starting point for looking at the epidemiology of type 2 diabetes in the United States. And you can also use these results to help you find even more articles. Let's say that you find an article you really like this white rice consumption and the risk of type 2 diabetes. Let's say you like that. Go ahead and click on it. And this brings you to the full record for this article. And if you scroll down, there's this link right here that says publication types, mesh terms, and grant support. If you click on that, you can look at what mesh terms this article is tagged with, and that might help you think of other things that you might want to try. Like, for instance, you can see that right here we have that statistics and numerical data subheading I told you about, affiliated with diet. So maybe you might want to try diet statistics and numerical data with diabetes mellitus type 2 epidemiology. That could be a good option. So that's a good way to figure out more ideas for your searching. And another thing you can do with a good article is you can look at these related citations in PubMed. If you hit see all, it runs an algorithm behind the scenes and it pulls up a bunch of articles that it thinks are similar to the article you're looking at. Sometimes this is really useful, other times it's not, but it's always worth looking at. Thank you for watching the tutorial on how to find statistics and journal articles about epidemiology research topics using library resources. If at any point you need or would like assistance, please feel free to contact the reference desk at 617-638-4228 or refquest@bu.edu.